Today on Real Chemistry, we're going to talk about limiting reactants. This really builds off a previous video, Introduction to Stoichiometry. So if you haven't watched that, go ahead and do that first. So what are we thinking about in this video? Well, we're thinking about recipes, whether it's for sandwiches or chemicals. And the question we want to ask ourselves is, given our recipe and the supplies we have in the kitchen or the supplies we have in the chemistry lab, how much of that product can we make? That product could be sandwiches, or it could be chemical products. So in the case of the sandwich, we know our recipe is 2 bread plus 1 cheese gives us 1 sandwich. And that's just our recipe. To know how many sandwiches we can make, we have to go into the kitchen and take a look at how many slices of bread and how many slices of cheese we have. So never get confused and think that the recipe is telling me anything about my ingredients. That's just what I would read in the cookbook. And what determines how much I can make is how many slices of cheese and how many slices of bread I actually have on hand. And it's the same with chemical reactions. Chemical reactions don't tell you how much stuff you can make. They tell you the recipe. And what tells me how much stuff I can make is what I have in the chemistry lab. So in this video, first we're going to take a look at sandwiches. And we're going to think about how many sandwiches we can make with a given amount of ingredients. And then we're going to go on to chemical reactions, and we're going to do the same thing. And the process is very similar. So first, let's think about sandwiches. Let's say that I go into the kitchen and I notice I have 8 slices of cheese and I have 12 slices of bread. The questions we want to answer here, and the same questions that we're going to want to answer in our chemical reactions, is how many sandwiches can we make and which one runs out first? Which one runs out, our cheese or our bread? So in this case, we see that we have 8 slices of cheese in the kitchen and we have 12 slices of bread. And so what we're gonna do is we're gonna think about how many sandwiches could I make with the cheese and how many sandwiches could I make with the bread. And that's gonna tell us overall how many sandwiches we could make, and it's gonna tell us which ingredient runs out first. So first, let's think about the cheese. Well, I have 8 slices of cheese, which I'll abbreviate SC. And my recipe tells me that for every slice of cheese, I can make 1 sandwich. So since I have 8 slices of cheese, then I can make 8 sandwiches with that cheese, which I'll abbreviate SAND. So that's what my cheese can make. My cheese can make 8 sandwiches. On the other hand, my bread, I have 12 slices of bread, which I'll abbreviate SB. And how many sandwiches could I make with that? Well, each sandwich requires 2 slices. And so that means I have to divide the number of slices of bread I have by 2. And I'll see that I can make 6 sandwiches. So you can make 6 sandwiches with 12 slices of bread. So notice I've calculated 2 quantities of sandwiches, 8 and 6. Only 1 of those actually gets made, right? Because I have 8 slices of cheese and 12 slices of bread. The ingredient that runs out first determines how many I can make. And you can see that the bread only allows me to make 6 sandwiches. And that means that's the amount that will actually be formed. It doesn't matter that when I go and I start making sandwiches that I get to my 6 sandwiches and I still have 2 slices of cheese left. There's no bread to pair them with. So it just doesn't matter. So I don't ever make my 8 sandwiches. I make 6 sandwiches. And my bread runs out first. Why does my bread run out first? Because that's the ingredient which produces the fewest sandwiches. So bread runs out. So this is the same sort of process we're gonna go through in our chemical reactions. We're gonna think about how much of our product could we make with each of our ingredients. The thing that can make fewer products is necessarily what runs out first. Our bread's gonna run out first because it can only make 6 sandwiches. So when I get to 6 sandwiches, it's all gone and I still have cheese left. And the thing that runs out first, we call our limiting reactant. That's the title of this video. That's what limits us from making more product. Our 6 sandwiches, in this case, is what we'd call a theoretical yield. And a theoretical yield is the most we could possibly make if everything goes perfectly. So 6 sandwiches is what we can make if things go perfectly, but that doesn't take into account the fact that I might drop some bread or maybe some of the cheese is moldy. So if things don't go perfectly, I might not even get 6 sandwiches. 6 is the maximum I could get. It's what we call our theoretical yield. And so we're gonna use these terms throughout this video. Theoretical yield, which means the amount of our product we can make if everything went perfectly, and limiting reactant, which means the thing that runs out first. Let's take a look at a chemical reaction now and do the same process. So here we have a chemical reaction that says we're combining 2 moles of chlorine and 1 mole of titanium, and we'll get out 1 mole of titanium chloride. And we go into the chemistry lab and we see that we have 8 moles of titanium and 12 moles of chlorine. And we want to answer the same exact questions. How many moles of titanium chloride can we make and which runs out first? And we're going to do this in the exact same way. We're going to first start off with our titanium. And we want to see how much we can make with our titanium. And here, I'm going to solve this problem the same way we did in our stoichiometry video with a conversion factor. Of course, you could also just say, okay, I have 8 moles of titanium, and my recipe tells me that I just need 1 mole of titanium per mole of titanium chloride. So that means I can make 8 moles of titanium chloride. And thinking through that that way is good, but the conversion factor way will always give you the right answer also. So we want to get rid of titanium, and we want to go to titanium chloride. And we fill in that conversion factors with the numbers from our chemical recipe, our chemical reaction. So we put in a 1 next to the titanium and also a 1 next to the titanium chloride. And that, just as we talked about, will tell me that I can make 8 moles of titanium chloride with my titanium. All right. So remember, we're not done at all, because that just tells me how much I can make with one of my ingredients. And if I want to think about what runs out first, I need to do it for both of my ingredients. So now I want to do it with chlorine, and I see that I start with 12 moles of chlorine. And again, I could just think about the fact that I need 2 moles of chlorine for every 1 mole titanium chloride, or I could write down a conversion factor. So I want to get rid of chlorine, and we'll notice that in front of chlorine in my chemical reaction is a 2. And I want to go to titanium chloride, and in front of my titanium chloride in my chemical reaction is 1. If you're having trouble following these conversion factors, go ahead and watch that stoichiometry video. We talk about them in more details there. All right, so that is going to cancel out my moles of chlorine, and I'm going to get moles of titanium chloride, and I'm going to see that I can make 6 moles of titanium chloride. Okay? So, now I've done all the math, and I just need to think about it here. Which one produces less? Well, my chlorine. And so that makes this the quantity I could actually make, because I'll never get to the 8 moles of titanium chloride, even though I have enough titanium, because I'll be going along making titanium chloride, and then my chlorine runs out, and so I stop making the product. So my theoretical yield in this case is my 6 moles of titanium chloride. That's the most titanium I could make if everything goes perfectly. I never get this. This doesn't occur because I don't have enough chlorine. And that means that the chlorine runs out first, and that the chlorine is what we call our limiting reactant. So limiting reactant, what runs out first? And that's equal to Cl2. In this video, we've introduced limiting reactants and theoretical yield. Remember, limiting reactants is the ingredient that runs out first, and theoretical yield is how much of a product we can make if everything goes perfectly. So we've also worded these problems in a pretty casual way. I recommend that you go on and watch my video, Limiting Reactants Practice Problems, and there we'll talk about them in terms that you might see in a chemistry textbook. If you have any questions, please leave them below. You can also subscribe to receive updates about future videos.